now light the second candle of Advent. Blessed are you, sovereign Lord, just and true. To you be praise and glory forever. Of old you spoke by the mouth of your prophets, but in our days you speak through your Son, whom you have appointed the heir of all things. Grant us, your people, to walk in this light, that we may be found ready and watching when he comes again in glory and judgment. For you are our light and our salvation. Blessed be God forever. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires are known, and from whom no secret is hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Please be seated. Thank you.
prepare ourselves day by day, moment by moment, for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, not only at Christmas time, but each and every day. In Advent, we are given the opportunity to look deep into ourselves, to examine our relationship with God, to examine our relationship with others, and indeed to examine our relationship with ourselves. During Lent, the period just before Easter, and especially on Ash Wednesday, we are reminded that we need to turn away from our sins and to believe in the good news. And we know that the good news is that our salvation is at hand. The good news that God loves us, and that God cares for us. The good news that there is an opportunity for each one of us to establish, to re-establish our relationship with God and neighbor. John the Baptist was seen as the forerunner of our Lord, was one who did just this. As a signpost to the one who was to come, he uttered those words, "Prepare the road for the Lord, make straight the path for him to travel." John's message significantly influenced the lives of many people. As they came to confess their sins and to be baptized as a sign of the remission of their sins. But there were those who could not be bothered, because John's message did not mean anything to them. Instead, they might have found themselves thinking that John was a bad person. Just look at the way he dressed. Look at the kind of food he ate. Look at what he wore. Locust and wild honey is part of the food. His image was not that of a prophet. But irrespective of the way in which people received him, whatever they thought of him, John would continue calling people to repentance and a renewal of life. He knew that he was only the forerunner, and that he who was to come was to bring about the real significant change, open the floodgates of God's mercy and God's love, God's acceptance and God's forgiveness to all of God's people. He knew that he was the one who was unworthy to carry the sandals of the one who was to come. The one, as John reminds, who baptized with water, with fire, and the Holy Spirit. The one who caused history to be changed forever. John had a very difficult task, because people in his day and age hardened their hearts. They could not understand what this new religiosity was all about, and how this was going to have to change, and why people needed to change. But little did they know that Jesus was the one that they had been waiting for forever. The one who was to come would in fact lead them into a deeper, more meaningful relationship with God. The one who was to come would break the yoke of sin and all that which oppressed them as God's people, especially as sin would spoil their relationship with God and with significant others. We know that people wanted to be free. They wanted to be free from those who oppressed them, those who meddled in their religious affairs. They wanted to, in their own words, to be free to worship God without any fear, with no interference from other secular powers or principalities. They even wanted their land back, the land that God gave them. Freedom to them meant to be free from the ones who oppressed them. However, God had something else in mind. Freedom to God meant for people to be free from that which really keeps them bondage, that which really oppresses them. Freedom to God means for them to be free from the sin sickness of society, their sinfulness and their wicked ways. freedom to God meant a total turnover. And that is why John the Baptist reminds them that they needed to turn away from their sins, and that they needed to turn to God, and that they needed to be transformed by God, so that they can become the people whom God has created them to be. In that reading from Isaiah, we read about a peaceful kingdom. What a wonderful image of the lion and the lamb lying together. And I'm sure that since creation, God has yearned this for God's people. God has yearned this for the society. God is yearning this for the church, that we are able to live in love and peace with our neighbor, that we'll be able to transform this world through the service that we offer, the genuine hospitality we are able to offer those who enter this place. The acceptance of those who have this need to belong. The affirmation of those who just need to have a good word shared to them. John's call for repentance in the image of the peaceful kingdom is one where people would find that solace and peace. Not to be turned away when they enter because of selfish attitudes, but one in which we would open our hearts and our lives for others to become part of this place. Repentance and faith for us in our context today is all about the way we are able to receive, to affirm, and to love. We, as the Church of God, are called to be the alternative society. We are called to be those who, through the way in which we offer the sense of hospitality and generosity, are able to transform the world for Christian ministry and service. We have a hostile world out there, where people do not take us seriously any longer. And I can understand why, because we don't even take ourselves seriously. We don't take seriously the commands of our Lord Jesus Christ. Here John calls us to repentance and faith. Sunday after Sunday, when we enter the space, we are called to repentance and faith. We are given those words of absolution, the reminder of God's love and God's forgiveness to all of God's people. But yet, we harden our hearts and we do not take heed of the words of God. And then we ask ourselves the question, why are others not coming to be part of who we are? When I used to teach confirmation, and people used to ask me questions about what does the devil look like, I often used to say to them, the best place to find or to see what the devil looks like is for us to look in the mirror. And then they would ask the question, what does God look like? And I would say the same thing to them. Look in the mirror. We can make the difference in the world, in society, and in the church. Especially in a place where so many people feel as if they do not belong. John calls us to repentance. There's this image of a peaceable kingdom. We are those who are called to be bridge builders, to work for justice, truth, and reconciliation. So our hearts are hardened, and nothing will change us. But I pray that through the message of John the Baptist today, through the season of Advent, as we continue to examine ourselves and our relationship with God, that we will really make a true turn and turn away from those things that distort the image of God within society. That we will turn away from those things that will make life or even church a living out of us, where they do not feel they want to enter any longer. But that we will do the kind of things that will transform this world through the love that we offer, through the persons that we can become, so that it's not only the lion and the lamb that will lie together, but each one of us, different though we might be. John calls us to turn away from our sins, to turn away from those things that will make life for ourselves even a living life. He calls us to assume the good, the right, and the acceptable things. May we, during this Advent season, do the things that God expects of us. Let us not only turn away, but let us turn to the goodness and the loving kindness of God and offer them to the least of our brothers and sisters. I can assure you, when we are able to do this and others see this, we will see the change that will be. The change needs to start with each and every one of us. The Lord be with you. Let us now stand and together affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father and the Mother, the
Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God from God, life from God, true God from true God.
We give thanks and pray for your world, for your people in the many nations that inhabit our planet, for the natural environment in which we have been placed, and for the rule of justice and equity amongst all nations and peoples. Bestow your grace upon our King Charles, our Prime Minister and members of Parliament, our Premier, and members of the Legislative Assembly, our Mayor and City Council, and the governments of every nation, remembering especially today Julie Freischmidt. When you come among us like the rising of the sun, may we with all your saints be ready to meet you and find our home in you. Lord, in your mercy.
Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Will you please remain seated for a moment? Sorry. I was just going to ask Victoria to bring Julian forward, please. Unfortunately, Dean Ken Mujer is still down with COVID, otherwise we'd have helped him as part of the service. And you'll understand what this is all about in a moment. Is it possible I can come out here? Dear friends in Christ, today we give thanks to God for Julian Malander and for many years of contribution to the Holy Trinity Cathedral here in Wangaratta, and more especially as a lay member of the Cathedral Chapter for many years. After prayerful consideration and with the approval of Bishop, Dean and Chapter of Holy Trinity Cathedral, we will now bestow the following honor upon Julian, following the retirement as the lay canon. Clarence, by divine permission, Bishop of Wangaratta, to our beloved in Christ, Mrs. Julian Mellon, greet you. Whereas you have been appointed in accordance with the provisions of the Cathedral Act 1972 to 2021, of the Synod of the Diocese of Wangaratta to the office of dignity of the lay canon of the Cathedral Church of Holy Trinity, Wangaratta, you do by these presents convey to you the title and honor of honorary lay canon of the Cathedral, with all the rights and responsibilities belonging thereto. In witness whereof, we have caused our episcopal seal to be affixed to these presents, this fourth day of December in the year of our Lord 2022, and in the third year of our consecration. Let us pray. Eternal God, you call us by grace to offer our gifts to the good before the plan you formed, before the foundations of the world, to open for us the way of salvation. Confident that your promise will be fulfilled, we now watch for the day when Christ our Lord will come again in glory. And so we join our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your glory, forever praising you. Merciful God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and wine. And we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he gave you thanks, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance."
Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Therefore, we do as our Saviour's command, and proclaiming his offering of himself, made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit. Unite us in the body of your Son. And bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship the Father in songs of never-ending praise. forsake this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with